and welcome to the Morningstar series, Why Should I Invest With You? I'm Emma Wall and I'm joined today by Henderson's Andrew Gillan.
Hi there.
Hi, good morning.
So today we're focusing on India in our Investing in Asia week. And India is actually a market that you feel pretty positive on, isn't it? You're overweight within the funds.
That's right. So at Henderson, in our Asian growth portfolios, we have about 20% allocation towards India. The reason that we like India is that it gives us good diversification in terms of Indian companies operating overseas and outside of the region, but also a good exposure to the domestic consumption story within India. So our largest position is in HDFC, which is the leading private sector mortgage company in India. It's got a really impressive track record of earnings growth and stability in net interest margins and spreads, despite volatility in interest rates and even kind of the political environment within India. So broadly speaking, we have good exposure to financial services, HDFC included, the consumer sector, but we're more measured because valuations are quite expensive in the consumer sector. We have a smaller position in DeBoer. And then we like pharmaceutical companies. So we've got two positions in the pharmaceutical sector, Lupin and Aurobindo. And we also like IT services. So we've added recently Infosys to the portfolios. And we have Tata Consultancy and Tech Mahindra as well. So again, we think these sectors can deliver good earnings growth despite sort of the environment within the region. From a macro perspective in Asia, India's maybe disappointed a little bit. There was this euphoria post, you know, Modi's election win.
Sentiment was very high.
That's right. And, you know, recently we had the Bihar state election, which was a disappointment for the government. So there has been disappointment, but I think as investors, we're quite realistic in terms of the pace of change within India. And the domestic economy is still doing relatively well compared with other parts of Asia.
And presumably that disappointment creates buying opportunities, because actually, as a fund manager, as a stock selector, you probably want sentiment to be too high. If sentiment high, that means probably prices are high. And as you say, following that successful election, the first non-coalition government in 30 years, everybody was very pro-India.
Yeah. So in 2014, India did very well and outperformed the region. So in 2015, I mean, what we've seen is really the market take pause. And India's done okay. Its currency's also held up relatively well because they've made good inroads in addressing the, you know, current account deficit, which was a concern of investors a number of years ago. But at the same time, there's been a pause for breath. And you know, earnings growth has also disappointed a little bit. It's still been among the strongest in Asia, but it's been less strong than expected at the start of the year.
India's been sort of hailed as the Holy Grail insofar as the two big threats to emerging Asia region is the fact that China is slowing down and also the fact that the US is beginning to look a little bit wobbly. But India is isolated in part from both of those. Do you think this means that it has the greatest chance of survival if those two things happen?
Well, we're more positive broadly on the region anyway, because I think the China slowdown in growth has been quite well flagged and it's part of an overall transition in the economy. So I think the Western commentators are blaming China for the slowdown in global growth, but actually it's quantitative easing in the Eurozone in Japan that's having a negative impact on global growth in US dollar terms. Yes, China is slowing, but it's still growing. And it's still growing at a reasonable rate relative to developed economies. But to your point, India is certainly more resilient against a weaker global backdrop because the domestic consumption story is very strong. But in order to achieve that, we are going to have to see more meaningful progress in politics, infrastructure investment, you know, more FDI, for example, which has been a criticism of India in the last decade or so.
And India is not the only region that you're positive on within Asia, is it? Where else are you overweight?
Selectively in ASEAN. So, you know, some markets like Malaysia, we don't have any exposure in our portfolios at the moment, just because the impact of the lower oil prices particularly impacted Malaysia. And it's also true that the lower commodity prices has impacted ASEAN generally and had a knock-on impact on consumption. So in markets like Indonesia, which is a very buoyant consumption story, you know, something like 250 million consumers, so it grabs the headlines as the next, you know, potential large market in Asia. And we've seen a real slowdown in consumption because of the lower commodity prices. So selectively, we've been looking at opportunities. We've maintained a position in Bank Rakyat, which does a lot of the micro lending and micro financing. We still think it's a good long-term story. We're looking at some of the consumer stocks like Astra and like Unilever, but we don't currently own those positions in the growth portfolios. On a brighter sort of note, where we're overweight, the Philippines. But the Philippines is such a small market that one can be overweight by only having one position. So one of our larger holdings is Ayala Corporation, for example, which is a diversified conglomerate, financial services, property, and also telecoms. And that's a good proxy for the environment in the Philippines. Thailand's probably a bit more controversial and a bit more non-consensus because given the political backdrop there, GDP growth has disappointed in Thailand. Infrastructure projects haven't come through. So we are kind of maintaining our position there, particularly in the banking sector with Cascorn Bank, for example, despite the weaker backdrop, because from a company specific backdrop, it's a good company, it's well run, but it lends to SMEs and SMEs are struggling at the moment. So the provisioning has increased and non-performing loans have disappointed a touch.
Andrew, thank you very much.
Thank you.
This is Emma Wall for Morningstar. Thank you for watching.